the judge. May it please the court, James Coon, Swanson, Thomas Coon, and Newton. On behalf of the plaintiff appellate, Maria Gutierrez, I would like to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal.
All right. Just keep an eye on the clock. You're budgeting yourself.
I appreciate that. Thank you. I do believe that our motion to for the court to take judicial notice of the transcript in the Zavalin case has been mooted, and we therefore withdraw it. The Rounds case covers that.
Keep your voice up, because I'm having a little difficulty.
I'll do that. We have filed a motion for the court to take judicial notice of the transcript in the Zavalin case. We did that because the Zavalin opinion did not itself mention the exchange between the ALJ and the vocational expert. The Rounds case, which we supplemental authority yesterday, its counsel has a copy of, takes care of that because it does recite that in the Rounds case, the exchange between the ALJ and the vocational expert was essentially identical to the exchange in this case. That is your testimony consistent with the dictionary of occupational titles? Question, answer, yes, I believe it is. That was the entire explanation from the vocational expert as to the dictionary of occupational titles. The problem in this case, of course, is that the ALJ found a residual functional capacity that said the claimant could not reach above her head. The only job the vocational expert found in response to the hypothetical question from the ALJ was cashier. And the DOT defines cashier to include reaching, which the DOT also defines as reaching in all directions. That is at least ambiguous as to whether that job matches the hypothetical, and we think it's certainly clearly contradictory and inconsistent under Zavalin and Rounds. The ALJ therefore had the obligation to inquire as to that inconsistency and to obtain an explanation as to that inconsistency. The exchange between the ALJ and the VE, which I just related, is it consistent? Yes, I believe it is. Does not do that. There's no explanation. There's no recognition of an inconsistency. The VE, in fact, denies any inconsistency. That was error under Zavalin and Rounds, and on that ground, the case should be reversed. The trial court below fixed on the word apparent. The law is, of course, that if there's an apparent inconsistency between the dictionary of occupational titles and the vocational expert's testimony, the ALJ has a duty to inquire. The law the government argued, and the court adopted this rationale, well, it's not apparent because the ALJ is not required to have an encyclopedic knowledge of the DOT. Doesn't have to have it all in his head, and I, the trial judge, don't think that this was apparent, that reaching means reaching in all directions, so the inconsistency wasn't apparent. The government doesn't defend that rationale on appeal, and I think in light of Zavalin and Rounds could not. The question is there in fact, does there appear to be, as we look at it on the record, an inconsistency between the vocational expert's testimony and what the DOT says? That's how Zavalin analyzes it. That's how the Rounds court analyzes it. It's not a question of the court figuring out whether this particular point is too narrow or specific or obscure for the ALJ to have understood it, because at hearing, the ALJ has the encyclopedia right there. When the VE says cashier, the ALJ says, okay, what's that number? The VE gives them the number. ALJ looks it up. It's about 100 words, a couple of sentences long, a description of the job, and then there's the inconsistency or not inconsistency. It's up to the ALJ to look at that and ask a question. When it says reaching in the DOT description, the ALJ should at the very least say, well, wait a minute. I told you she can't reach over her head. How do you explain that, Mr. Vocational Expert? That's how it should go. That's not an unreasonable burden for the ALJ to do that, and it is the ALJ's burden to develop the record in this respect.
Can I ask some hypothetical questions having to do with weight and the ability to lift certain amounts of weight?
The ALJ DHA's residual functional capacity included a limitation to 5 pounds lifting with the right hand, 20 pounds with both hands.
Weren't hypotheticals posed by the ALJ that the vocational expert that took that into consideration contemplated that limitation?
That hypothetical included that limitation. The vocational expert answered with the cashier's job. There was no questioning by the ALJ concerning that. Plaintiff's counsel at the hearing questioned the vocational expert about the lifting limitation, not about the overhead reaching, but about the lifting limitation. The government argues that that questioning somehow explains the inconsistency, but it doesn't. It doesn't address at all the reaching requirement, which is the problem here, because there's nothing about the reaching requirement discussed. The VE never explains it at all. The counsel can point to a place in the record where the VE explains the reaching inconsistency on all ears, but I don't think that is going to happen here. The inconsistency is clear. The ALJ did nothing to unearth it, identify it, get it explained. That was error under Zeldwain and Rounds. This court should reverse the decision below.
Mr. Cota, are you including in your claim of the ALJ inadequacy any idea that the ALJ did not inquire as to the effects of the medication that Gutierrez was taking, causing her to take midday naps?
It's not that the ALJ failed to inquire, it's that the ALJ failed to give reasons that were specific about specific testimony. He referred to the claimant's testimony in general, her application and testimony. He never said anything about her need to sleep during the day, to take naps, her fatigue. He didn't say that was not credible for any particular reason.
So is your position that failing to ask that question and follow up on that line was incapacitating as to the opinion of the ALJ because he should have asked the VE, can cashiers take midday naps?
We have not made that allegation. We have not made that argument in the brief.
No.
There are two separate arguments. The VE argument is about reaching and the inconsistency with the DOT. The plaintiff's credibility argument is about the ALJ's failure to identify specifically any of her testimony. He referred to it in large and said it was not credible. The trial court below agreed with us on that point, but said it was harmless error because we could identify no connection between the issues she had, her medical impairments, and her fatigue. Our argument on that is that she was taking medications that are well known to cause fatigue, that connection certainly is made, so that error was not harmless.
The reaching limitation of Ms. Gutierrez is upward reaching, right?
Overhead with her right hand, that's correct.
Ever since I've read everything, I've been trying to conceive under what circumstance a cashier would have to do that. I remember going into old stop-and-goes for gas, and I think they used to keep cigarettes above. Somebody ordered cigarettes, but is that common now? I mean, I would think that the ability to reach one way or the other in front, maybe behind you, is part of being a cashier, but overhead?
Well, I think that is one example. Cigarettes overhead, lottery tickets are sometimes kept above, things on top of the cashier. Claim is 4'11", so she has to reach up more than most people do. Although, as a matter of process, I don't believe that we can anecdotally look at our last trip to the local Fred Meyer and say, well, what did we see? It's really up to the vocational expert to say, well, maybe in this percentage of those jobs, or whatever he might have said had he been asked.
The vocational expert testified that he had taken into consideration some of the claimant's limitations and reduced the number of available or eligible jobs by some quotient, right? Do you understand that testimony to mean he took into consideration the lifting weight limitations that she had rather than the ability to reach over her head?
Right, and you could look at that testimony and say, well, he was talking about the use of her hands, and, well, if she was reaching over her head, she would have been using her hands. But there's no explicit conversation about the fact that it's going over her head, which is a problem with her shoulder, as opposed to just the using of her hands to lift 5 pounds, for example.
Can you go over again your claim as to the drowsiness. I know Judge Bay asked you some questions. I just want to understand what you're arguing on appeal with the error by the ALJ as to your client's drowsiness due to the medication.
The requirement for findings of credibility is that the ALJ must specifically identify that testimony found not to be credible. The ALJ said the claimant's application and testimony are not credible because they're inconsistent with their daily activities, etc. Her testimony is not credible in general. That's all he ever said. He never said her testimony about fatigue, her testimony about drowsiness, and he didn't identify what he was talking about.
So if that's correct, and let's say hypothetically we agree with you, although of course we're going to hear from the other side, if we were to agree with you on that point, couldn't we send this case back to resolve that issue and include language in an opinion saying, and by the way, also the ALJ needs to make it clear on the reaching issue to clarify the issue there. Couldn't we resolve the case that way?
That's right. You could. We have not argued for remand for payment of benefits. I mean, after the Tricler case and other cases, I don't think this is a case that we could make a credible argument on that. So, yes, one could send it back for those two things. In fact, that's what we would urge the court to do.
You said the ALJ wasn't specific enough in its credibility findings. It's true, as I read the record, that he didn't discuss the drowsiness, but didn't he say that he believed your client exaggerated the extent of her disability in that there was other evidence that she was able to go shopping, she was able to do some household chores, and yet when she testified in front of the ALJ, she minimized those things, and he believed that she was exaggerating the extent of the disability. Didn't he make that finding?
That would be our point, that he exaggerated, she exaggerated, he said, the extent of her disability. How disabled she is, that's as general as one can get in a
That's a basis for credibility finding, though, right?
It is, but what he should say, if he's being specific, as required by this court's holdings, is she exaggerated the extent to which she has to sleep during the day. She exaggerated her physical weakness of her hands. She exaggerated this or that. He doesn't say what, just her disability in general. That's the problem.
Well, her disability is her right shoulder, inability to lift above the shoulder level.
Among other things. There are a number of things that she can't do. She has
She's also obese, but isn't that the disability? She can't lift her right arm above her shoulder?
Her disabilities include that, but they also include the side effects of her pain medications, which require her to sleep in the daytime. It includes her inability to do a number of the household things that one does. She has adult children who help her with those things. And now that's into an argument about the actual reasons on which the trial court agreed with us, that those reasons were not, in fact, clear and convincing.
Is it possible that he believed her on the drowsiness score, but he didn't believe her on the range of limitations? I mean, you say he had to do more. He pointed out that there was a difference in what she'd said before about her ability to go shopping, her ability to do household chores, and then what she testified to. To me, that sounds like a credibility finding. You're not testifying the same way as you've told us before. He omits any talk about the drowsiness. Maybe he believed her on that.
Maybe he did. We don't know is the point. He did not say what he didn't believe. He gave general reasons. Here, she can do all this stuff, so I don't believe her testimony. I don't believe her allegations and testimony.
But your position is, in addition to pointing out the apparent inconsistency in something she'd said before and then she said in front of him, he had to say, and therefore because of the inconsistency, I don't believe her.
What he did not do was point out an inconsistency between this and that, these things that she has said, and therefore I don't believe one of them. He wasn't specific about that. He said there are inconsistencies in her testimony. She could do these daily activities. So her testimony, I don't believe. Her allegations, I don't believe. He didn't say what specifically he didn't believe, and this court's decisions do require that. Thank you very much.
Please, the court, counsel Lars Nelson on behalf of the Commissioner of Social Security. This court should affirm the final decision of the commissioner because it is supported by substantial evidence. I'd like to first start with by explaining how the Rounds case supports the ALJ's finding in the present case. In Rounds, there was a conflict between the vocational testimony, which the hypothetical restricted the claimant to 1 to 2 step tasks, and the general educational development level. The vocational expert said that the claimant could do jobs that are at the second level of reasoning, but the vocational expert did not explain how that was consistent with the fact that the general educational development level 1 specifically includes the words 1 to 2 step tasks. And what the court says in Rounds is ostensibly, and that's the key word they used, the vocational testimony might be consistent. A hypothetical limiting to 1 to 2 step tasks on the one hand might be consistent with reasoning level 2. But the court says the problem is here, in this case, the vocational expert did not address that reasoning level 1 contains the language 1 to 2 steps. That is not the issue here. On page 45 of the transcript, after the ALJ poses the hypothetical, including overhead reaching, and the vocational expert testifies that the only job available is cashier, the ALJ follows up with, is that the only job? And the vocational expert testifies, yes, it is, because no other job can accommodate the restrictions of the right dominant extremity. So here, there is not the error that was in Zavalin. There is not the error that was in Rounds. The vocational expert specifically noted, I'm considering the full limitation, not to just hand, not to just the fingering or wrist, to the right dominant extremity. And I believe that this testimony carries over when the vocational expert says that he's restricting the job numbers to accommodate for this right extremity. And this is consistent with Social Security ruling 8312, which anticipates that vocational experts will be able to testify about someone who has lost the complete use of a limb. The argument here is that the ALJ must assume that reaching refers to all reaching. For example, if the case was judges, if you look under the Dictionary of Occupational Titles, a judge is required to reach occasionally, meaning 1/3 of the day. And under Gutierrez's argument, the ALJ would have to presume that 1/3 of the day a judge looks like they're out in an orchard picking apples. The Dictionary of Occupational Titles is silent as to the specific type of reaching, the specific direction of reaching involved in the job. And the ALJ is entitled to rely on vocational expert testimony consistent with SSR 8312 to resolve, to fill that silence. And there is not a presumed error or presumed ambiguity. Now, the arguments in this case about administrative notice and the other issues gets to the fact of there are, in effect, two errors that are alleged, and they're kind of treated as the same. One is the failure to inquire, is there a conflict? And one is the failure to resolve a conflict. Now, the first one, in effect, they're both procedural errors. But here, when the ALJ inquires, is there a conflict, and the vocational expert says, no, the ALJ's duty to develop, it has been resolved. Now, that error may be consequential, because there might be an apparent error, conflict, between the Dictionary of Occupational Titles on the one hand and the vocational testimony. The ALJ obviously has a duty to resolve that, regardless of how it comes up. But the ALJ does not have to, after the receiving testimony that there is no conflict, the ALJ does not have to presume a conflict where the Dictionary of Occupational Titles is silent. The ALJ would only have error, the second error, failing to resolve the conflict if the conflict is apparent. And that is kind of the issue that this court is circling with Zavalin and with Rounds, is what is an apparent conflict? And in that case, it's apparent because the court can look to the general educational development level and the specific limitations in the hypothetical and is able to easily compare language. That is not the case for reaching. And even if it was, the vocational expert obviously addressed reaching here, consistent with SSR 8312. Turning to the subjective complaints. In this case, the ALJ specifically enumerated the claimant's subjective complaints. On page 19 of the transcript, the ALJ goes into great detail summarizing them, and then goes later in the decision, the ALJ provides specific reasons for discounting the subjective complaints, obviously referring back to that earlier summary. Now, that earlier summary does not specifically say the claimant alleges fatigue and the claimant alleges that she has to lie down during the day. But her full testimony at the hearing is actually that she experiences fatigue, she lays down during the day, when she gets up again, she tries to work around the house, but she really can't do anything. And what the ALJ in summarizing the testimony says is she alleges disability and the inability to sustain full-time work. So we're really getting into the level of specificity required by the ALJ when considering, when enumerating the symptoms alleged by the claimant. And it's the commissioner's position that this is not a scouring undertaking that the ALJ has to go through, where the ALJ has to find every utterance of possible utterance of every symptom. It is enough for the ALJ for the court to say the ALJ considered this issue and considered the symptoms, properly summarized them, and then later provided specific reasons. And I think that this is particularly the case here, where the reasons provided by the ALJ are broad and cover numerous symptoms. For example, in this record, she testified that she can only lift about 10 pounds with her right dominant extremity. Earlier in the record, she says that she could only lift 5 pounds. Now, the ALJ didn't cite this as an inconsistency, but it is an inconsistency that if it were used for credibility, you'd say, yeah, that inconsistency only applies to lifting. You couldn't use that inconsistency to potentially discount the claimant's allegation that she feels fatigue and has to go to sleep. But that's not the reasons the ALJ cited. The reasons here cover a broad range of activities. The reasons here include her looking for other work, and the reasons here include her working the same amount of hours after the allegedly disabling accident as she did before the allegedly disabling accident. The reasons also include her daily activities, which include caring for a 2-year-old infant, where she described changing diapers, even being able to change diapers even with one hand. Now, these sorts of activities cover a broad range of symptoms, and they call into question, and I think the court's question about her nominal effort on examination also calls into question a broad range of symptoms. On 2 different occasions before 2 consultative examiners, she displayed giveaway weakness, and on one it was specifically noted that it was a nominal effort on examination. And this court has said that that is probative of symptom testimony. If this court disagrees that the ALJ's summary was sufficient to cover symptom testimony, the commissioner would also argue that this is harmless error in this case. symptom testimony is made as part of the residual functional capacity assessment. And here, the ALJ's residual functional capacity assessment is fully supported by unchallenged medical opinions. Now, the harmless error standard enunciated in Molina, and quoting Shinseki v. Sanders, the Supreme Court case, is that it must be consequential to the ultimate non-disability determination. It's not a question of if the ALJ were to consider this, might the ALJ come out with a different conclusion? No, under substantial evidence review, if the evidence could go either way as a whole, the court must side with the ALJ. And in here, the ALJ had specific medical opinions that are unchallenged on appeal that support every one of the limitations in the residual functional capacity assessment, and none of them include a restriction based on fatigue or laying down during the day.
What about the argument that the ALJ, in terms of making its credibility finding, just says she's not credible and doesn't break it down as much as opposing counsel would like?
Well, obviously it would make judicial review and our arguments a lot easier if the ALJ said, I reject specific symptom X because of reason Y. But going back all the way to Megalini's, this court has said that this court, we don't have to use magic words. The ALJ doesn't have to use magic words where the ALJ says, I reject this opinion because, and this court can draw reasonable inferences from the testimony here. This testimony that she had to, she felt fatigue and had to lie down is subordinate to her other symptoms. She said she testified the main reason she was disabled was her arms. So the ALJ's reason and discussion goes to those main reasons. At the end of the day, I think that this court can reasonably read that the reasons apply broadly and cover this specific testimony. And even without it, we have medical opinions that support the residual functional capacity assessment.
But you can't point us to anywhere in the transcript or in the order where the ALJ did say, look, she says she's tired, I don't buy it.
No, not where she says she's tired or fatigue. Now, her whole testimony is those translate into the inability to do anything. And I think when the ALJ says that she alleges total disability and the inability to sustain full-time work, that the ALJ is taking that into account. And the ALJ also has to look at the record as a whole. And Gutierrez, in the briefing, ties her limitation to a drug that she started 2 months before the hearing. And the ALJ, though, gave consideration to the fact that she was taking only ibuprofen throughout much of the record for this pain, and it actually helped her. So the ALJ, this is not a case where the ALJ didn't consider treatment or symptoms at all. Instead, the ALJ focused on the record as a whole. And in the Carmichael case, this court said that a conflict with a medical opinion is a fundamental reason to discount subjective complaints. And in Molina, this court, in discussing what would be a harmless error, said if the ALJ relied on more credible testimony of an acceptable medical source, that could constitute harmless error. I think those two cases together clearly illustrate that even if the ALJ erred in not specifically mentioning fatigue and laying down, that the ALJ, at the end of the day, could have hung his hat on the fact that there was objective medical evidence in the form of acceptable medical sources, doctors' opinions, treating and examining, who supported the RFC and did not include these limitations.
The ALJ found that the claimant's subjective complaints and alleged limitations are not fully persuasive or consistent with her work history. If she doesn't have the pain, she doesn't have to take the medication. If she doesn't take the medication, she doesn't have to sleep.
Well, she only started that medication on the eve of the hearing. So prior to that, she was just taking ibuprofen, and she was able throughout that time to do her activities such as care for her children full time. So it didn't impede with that. Unless the court has any further questions, I'm going to ask the court to affirm.
I'd like to go back to the vocational expert issue, if that's fine with the court. The citation that's relevant is ER 62. ER 45 is the middle of the medical discussion of the ALJ's opinion. ER 62 is where the ALJ and the vocational expert have their entire discussion about the reaching requirement. And that is to say, no discussion. Here is that entire discussion. ALJ, based on this hypothetical, can you identify any jobs that you, any occupations you believe such an individual will be able to perform? Answer by the VE. Since it's the right hand, dominant hand, that's most affected, I think that would have a pretty significant impact. I think potentially cashiering jobs could be performed with the capacity you noted. That's light, unskilled SVP2 work. That's about skills. Greater than $200,000, 200,000 numbers in the national economy. Is that the only occupation you could think of? I think so. I think that the other jobs that I have considered would require more use of the dominant right extremity. Is that consistent with the DOT? I believe it is. That's it. There's no discussion, no implication, nothing that would help us understand about the reaching requirement. Counsel says that the reaching requirement, there's no reason to presume that the reaching requirement is at issue here. The fact is the DOT says reaching. The fact is the DOT defines reaching as reaching in all directions, and the commissioner agrees with that in SSR 8515. That's a definition. It means something. If you're going to say that somebody can do a job that requires that kind, that requires reaching, and this person cannot reach over their heads, you're going to have to explain, okay, how is that? Because those are, on their face, inconsistent. So I think the error is clear. The discussion is null about reaching overhead, about that requirement. There's no effort to explain it. That is the ALJ's duty. It is at the very least ambiguous, which invokes the ALJ's duty to develop the record. If the court is on.
You've exhausted your time.
I am.
It's submitted now. Gutierrez versus Colvin is submitted. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And the next case is Knutson Towboat Company versus Wakeley.